creator of EcoPath, Dr. Christensen, our co-director of the Fishery Center, has made many waves with his publications worldwide. They can be read in all sorts of different journals, and including Science and Nature, as well as in the New York Times, and in all different science podcasts. You can listen to his work as well. So obviously I could go on for much longer and talk about Dr. Christensen's excellent work, but I decided to keep it short. And if you want to know more details, check out his website at the Global Ocean Modeling website.org. And please join me in welcoming Dr. Christensen.
Notes of accents? I want two. But you say tomato, and I say tomato. And you may think I'm totally nuts. Does anyone remember that song? Of the younger ones? You have heard about it? Yes. I can't even remember who it was, but it's something with, let's work the whole thing out.
It's called
Holding On. Yeah, and you know, that part. I'm thinking of the other part. Anyway, I was thinking of that one this morning, because I was thinking about how am I going to explain this. You know, we say fishing down the food web. And if you go south of the border, they say fishing through the food web. And there is this this controversy about what we are actually doing to the oceans. Are we fishing down? Are we fishing through? If we want to be really participatory, we should have a vote now. But I'll spare you for that one. You know, one of these here where you can go in and see, can you actually change people's mind? I can give you the end of the story now. I haven't thought about that, there's an end to it. I would want you to raise all your three arms. When we come to the vote, one for fishing down, one for fishing through, and one for fishing up. Is that a good way of summarizing my talk? Or am I really out on thin ice now? Well, let's see where we're going. The first thing about fishing down the food web, if we're talking about whether we're doing it or not, we need to define it. And this here is, I believe, the first published definition of fishing down. So, we can expect unfished ecosystems to be in some kind of balance. You can read them much quicker than I can say it. But the key issue is there is originally a high abundance of predatory fish. Fisheries may initially target these. That may lead to more catches of lower in the food web, or species lower in the food web. And there may be a gradual process that leads to this fishing down the food web process. To me, that's the process that we're talking about when we're talking about fishing down the food web. It's a process, and I would call it an evolutionary process. It's something that happens over a long time. Tony has been looking a lot on how ecosystems were once upon a time, like 10,000 years ago or 1,000 years ago. Now, those ecosystems are part of what's in this definition here. That's what we're talking about. Fishing down the food web, the way it's defined, is a process, something that happens over time. So that's one thing to keep in mind when we're going to have that vote later on. Another one relates to the implications of fishing down the food web. One possible implication, also from the same paper, defined this. We may expect potential catches to increase if we fish out the predators and fish on their prey. And it shouldn't be a big surprise, it hypothesizes that if we were to fish one trophic level lower, catches should be 10 times higher, roughly. Or is that a surprise to anyone here? I should ask the Fish 500 and 520 students. Would that be a surprise to anyone? Well, it's based on the assumption, it's more than an assumption, the finding that as the productivity decreases with about productivity one trophic level higher is about 10% of what it was at the trophic level below it. And you know, each time a predator takes a prey, we go up one trophic level. So the productivity is 10 times bigger at one trophic level below. Now, if we could extract, if we could just remove all the predators, turn things into an agricultural single species system, all what that implies, poison, nutrients, and so on, we would be able to catch 10 times more. That was what the assumption was in here. And in that paper, there is an early meta-analysis of ecosystems indicating cats versus trophic level. Lots of dots, there's total cats from ecosystems, from 30-something ecosystems, indicating that we get 8 times more cats if we move one trophic level down. So that actually indicates, yeah, we should get more cats out of it. Part of the process again. But are we actually fishing down the food web? That's something that's hotly debated now. Pointing out here, the process again, that's how it was originally conceived. Now, the next step after this definition here was a paper. Daniel got a smart idea. In the 96 paper, what it there was just to examine the world's catches to see where we were. There were lots of top predators in the world's catches. So what Daniel did for the 98 paper was to say, look, take the FAO catches and use the indicator that's fishing down the food web. That one had been around for some decades. The mean trophic level. I should have prepared myself better. Maybe you are allowed to. When you're fishing down the food web, mean trophic level of the cats, you know, they're often being used as synonyms. What I'm trying to say, they're not synonyms. There's a process called fishing down the food web. There's an indicator called mean trophic level. That's the indicator that was developed in the 1998 paper. And the smart thing about that study was really that it quantified how based on FAO catch statistics, it quantified what's the mean trophic level of fisheries catches from 1950 up to now, mid-90s. How's that look? The paper did not deal with the process as such. You can see there, that's in a follow-up paper, a response to the science paper. Did not state or imply that low trophic level species increased the contribution to global catches because of depletion of the predators. This fishing down the food web is a long-term thing. How much we see in the short term is a question. An important question that we're going to return to a number of times. What the 1998 paper presented was globally trophic levels versus here. And we saw from marine systems, for freshwater systems, that the average trophic level was declining. So that's what the indicator told us. It also showed some interesting trends for, you know, some cases like northwestern Central Atlantic, initial increase and then decrease. Northeast Atlantic, which is one of the most studied areas, most heavily exploited areas, and quite a neat constant decrease. That was interesting. But even more interesting about this was when you took it in the context, do we actually get more fish out of it? We looked at that and found there were a number of backward bending curves, we called them. You see for the Northwest Atlantic here. No, that's not a good example. Let's go to Northeast Atlantic. Initially 1950, we started up here. And over time, catches increased from this level and doubled, more than doubled up here, as trophic levels were decreasing. So that's actually pretty neat. We are catching more and the trophic levels are going down. It's quite consistent with how we formulate the ideas in that process there. But then you see suddenly, whoops, they start bending backwards. And you suddenly get lower catches at lower trophic level. Now that indicates we interpret it as a warning signal. Something is happening in these ecosystems. The indicator, mean trophic level of the cats, tells us something is going on in these ecosystems. Not clear from the indicator what it is, but something was going on. And we saw that in a number of other systems when we looked at them region by region, that these curves have this backward bending trend. So, separate here. I think you're getting the process. There may be a fundamental process, but it's not one like a universal truth, like a law that you have to follow that law or you end up in jail. It's not like that. It's a process that is a very fundamental process. But the process, the indicator that we're using for this, the mean trophic level, clearly had some biases. Funny thing about this was pointed out by John Catty and Garcia and Granger and other people from FAO in a response that came soon after in Science. And what they said was basically, if we reinterpret what they're saying was, you can't use FAO data for this purpose. They're not good enough. That's one interpretation of it, at least. But let's see what they actually raised some valid points. I'm not trying to harass them at all. They raised some really valid points. The other part of it is more the funny twist on it. They pointed out there was a very low taxonomic resolution in the FAO catch data. That's true. And that was a problem. How can you assign things at tropic levels to species that are not elsewhere included? A lot of the FAO catches were that. And actually, for those working with the sea around us, what you can see here is ideas that led to the Sea Around Us project. Very important aspect of this was realizing that there are lots of problems with the FAO catch data, and the FAO catch data, to a large extent, is what we know about the world ocean. So issues there. There were issues about the very coarse trophic level estimates, and we did not account for ontogenetic changes. As you will know, most fish tend to eat, start up as planktivores, and many of them gradually change to another diet. In many cases, they start eating fish, become piscivores. Very typical for the larger fish, the table fish, those we like to eat, that there is this shift in diet. That's not considered here. So that's two issues. Or two more, which are more important. I'll treat all of these four. Actually, five. There's one that didn't get in that paper. The next one there is landing data do not reflect ecosystem abundance. We'll get back to that. Fishing technology and prices impact landings. Yes, fishers change target species. Prices are really important for that. Short term, that has a lot of indications. We'll come back to it. And spatial aggregation, something we added on later. The first two issues there relating to the taxonomic resolution, the coarse trophic levels, and this ontogenetic, something that Daniel and company has looked at in a lot of detail, and quite clearly, when you account for these things, it pulls the other way. It makes the trend in the indicator stronger when you do that. But does catches reflect abundance? No, not always, far from always. But if there are no fish, you can have no catch. So at least there is something of that kind. But it's not so that a 10% increase or decrease in catches automatically imply something about abundance. That may just be a question of how the fishing fleets are operating. That's quite clear. Note here, the fish and down food web have been seen from trawl surveys, including. That did one of the first studies that used that did that. But I would even question those if we actually know so much from this, because trawl surveys do not reflect what's in an ecosystem. Trawls are size selective, and there are clearly things you don't get from them. So you really have to interpret that very carefully. I think in many ways, actually, ecosystem models may even tell you more about this, because at least they can get some of the correct for some of those things you don't see, is just use short surveys. And typically that's what I do. So clearly, this is an issue. The indicator, mean traffic level, does not necessarily tell us what happens in the ecosystem. It's not, you know, it's an indicator. Remember that, it's not the perfect world that comes out of that indicator. Yes, it has some flaws, of course it has. There are some important questions there. Do cats reflect abundance? This has led to one of the most silly papers I have read in a long time. You have these two counterparts, and it's like two, what do they call this? No, it's more, they think of it more, I was just about to compare to these wild fighting matches you might occasionally see if it's happened to you on TV. But you have two partners being brought in there to fight each other. And I say that because I'm going to return to this several times. There is this controversy between people at the University of Washington and here at the Fisher Center. But no one really believes that cats reflect abundance without qualifications. There are lots of qualifications. If you read this article, certainly when I read it, point out two things there. Knowing what tonnage is pulled out of the ocean these years is crucial. Catch data are a crucial part of any assessment. We need to know how much we extract from the oceans. Yeah, it may not be given telling us what the abundance of species is, but it's crucial information. So this controversy here is, to me, a little bit like, I'm a Dane, we have these expressions. I don't think you have this one here. A storm in a glass of water? What is the English expression for that? What?
Tempest in a teapot. Making a big thing out of something.
Yeah.
It's actually a teacup. Not
a teacup?
It's a teacup. Anyway, to me, it has an aspect of this. But it's an important issue. What can we extract? What can we tell about what happens in the ecosystem based on catches? We can clearly say some, but using that for managing fisheries? No. That would be that might be a pretty scary thing to do if you just did that blindly. You had no assessments, no nothing going on. You really have to think about it. It's a two-sided thing. Let's look at some of the other aspects of this. Technology impacts fisheries. And yes, they do. Fisheries change. And what the heck was I thinking when I brought in the central limit theory into this? Anyone guess what that, you know what it is? I know. I could ask Murdoch to explain it. But if you have some kind of a distribution and you extract a lot of variables from it, estimates, they are independent estimates, what you come up with tends to be a beautiful bell curve. It has absolutely nothing to do with fishing down the food web. What I want to say with this is, when you have a lot of fisheries, and you send those fisheries out to take what's out there, they will get it. And when they do that, it matters a lot how vulnerable you are to fishing. This here is from FishBase. Takes a large number of species, as you can see from the dots, noticing I don't remember how many, got the trophic level this way, and on the other way is William Chung's intrinsic vulnerability, which is not based on trophic level. It's based on broad, fecundity if it's low, distribution of rains, the K is there, the maximum size is there, and three or four more things. And I forgot.
Facial behavior and
length.
Length, yeah, body size.
Yeah, that would help.
Yes.
So, William did a really nice study from years ago where he quantified the vulnerability to fishing, intrinsic vulnerability to fishing. Now, if you look at that, you see a clear relationship with traffic level. So, that's where my central limit theory comes in. You go out fishing, you fish for what's out there. There was fish for krill. Earlier, many years ago. Anyway, you go out there and you fish what's there. When you do that, the higher trophic level will overall be more impacted. That's why I brought in the central limit theory. It was not artillery. It was not an error. So spatial application was the thing that something that Daniel and company has been working a lot with. And when you look at that special spatial aggregation, they tend to mask fishing down the food web. So they impact the indicator, not the process, they impact the indicator that we use to quantify fishing down the food web. But then comes Tim Eschington. He looked sea once catch data in more detail. He took the indicator and he dissected it and looked at what's behind that. That's actually an interesting thing to do. So he found fishing down the food web in 30 out of 48 last marine ecosystems that he looks at. But only in a few of those, 9, there were declining catches of the higher trophic level species. And he raised the question there in PNAS, I think it was, are we fishing down the food web? Or are we actually fishing through the food web? And you can see there's a point there. If you catch that many high trophic levels and you catch this many low trophic levels, you have an indicator that's the mean of those, it's there. Now this thing here grows bigger, mean goes down. That would be indicating of fishing through the food web. And you know what? There's something to it. Tomato, you know, that's that part again. Depends a lot on how you look at it. But remember, we're talking about an indicator. And yes, there are clearly cases where we're fishing through the food web. There are also cases where we're fishing down the food web. There are cases where we are fishing up the food web as well. This all happens. My basic view on this is really, we have a really pitiful lack, or we have a really, try again. I'm getting confused because it's raining down here, you know. Not right now, but usually it is this time of year. We know way too little about what happens in the ocean. We don't have any way, any monitors that tells us every fish that swim by, other than in a few cases like they're doing it. No, we don't know too much about what happens in the ocean. Therefore, we have to rely on indicators. And mean trophic level is such an indicator. And just like the GDP is an indicator of growth in the ecosystem, in the economy, mean trophic level is an indicator of something in the ocean. And just like the GDP, it's far from perfect. But it may well be the best we have. Recognizing this, the CBD, which I have a lot of respect for because of the 195 countries or so that have signed on to the Convention on Biological Diversity, and who in their strategic plan, the EG targets, have expressed how we should be managing our fisheries. Just one of many. This one has a little bit of teeth because it's not legally binding. But what you see is that questions are being raised in the parliament here in Canada about how Canada is living up to its obligations. Now, that may not sway our present government, but it impacts policies. And these are the kinds of things that actually can do it. The CBD is using the Marine Trophic Index, which is the indicator we're talking about, the trophic level of the catch, as the one that is the key indicator for this. Now, with all its flaws and so on, that can be scary, yes. But, say it again, we need indicators, and we cannot expect to have, you know, one indicator tells us all we need to know. It does not work like this. I argue one is not enough. We need to look at things from different views. I also argue, yeah, that some of the key issues for indicators are they have to be easy to calculate and explain. Making trophic level lives up to that. We are getting these countries. All for the there's a COP going on. A Western COP going on, Conference of the Parties, 2 weeks ago in Korea, Before that, all countries had to report how they were doing on the mean traffic level of the cats. One of the indicators, they had to come up with that. Now that means they had to look at the ecosystems. It means they have to look at what is traffic levels. They had to think about this. Now, that's a big step in the right direction. You see when this happens. So we need indicators. And we cannot expect that one indicator gives us the universal truth. It does not. Just like the GDP again. One indicator we have added to that mix is the FIB index, the fishing and balancing index. And do you know what a FIB is? I'm talking to you because you are not a native speaker. Mm-hmm. No, nope, I didn't either. FIB is a small lie of the kind you tell your children. You know, in order to. So that's the funny thing about the FIB index. The FIB index is an index that captures what we started with. When we go one traffic level down, do we get 10 times as high cats? Now, if you lock that, that's what this does. You get zero. So if the FIB index stays at zero, we may be fishing up or down, but when we fish up, we get lower cats, and when we fish down, we get higher cats. That will balance out with the FIB index. And this here, I'm not going to explain it, is actually something of the way we recommend you look at what happens in the ecosystem with very simple indicators. Keep it simple. So we have the catches, we have what happens to the traffic level here versus the catch. There's a FIB index, which increases initially. Typically, that's an expression of expansion in the fisheries, spatial expansion or getting to fully exploit the ecosystem. And then it decreases. And we can see in this case here, this is actually, you know, this is an example where you take one of those where it works nicely here because we're talking about the Northwest Atlantic and the collapse of the cod, that's what you see here. So yes, it works really well when you have drastic things like mismanagement of species, like the cod fisheries, into the picture. It doesn't always work, but when you look at these, you have a much better picture of what happens. So again, it's great to have indicators. We must have indicators, but it's not sufficient. Not one indicator. Cannot expect that. So summing it up, are we fishing down the food web? How many votes in favor? I hope I can get everyone here now to raise their hands 3 times. You don't have to, but you get my point now. We look at this, and when we look at this, we look at it in, oh, we have a time series here. We've been studying this system here for the last 15 years, and it tells us, we're not fishing down the food web here, we're fishing up the food web. And yeah, the indicator is going up. That's what's happened. But what about the process? What happens to that process there? That would be my next question. And you haven't had a pretty picture. Isn't this a nice coral reef? Isn't this the kind of healthy ecosystems that we need to protect? No? Isn't this a healthy ecosystem? It's cutting the microphones off. That's why people couldn't hear it. So I need to say it again.
Say it again.
I need to say it. Isn't this a healthy ecosystem? What?
Where's the shark?
Where's the shark? No, there are sharks. Okay, you can get one more. So there's no shark here either. But what there is here is a lot of fish. And I deliberately took those that didn't have any sharks in them. But you think about a healthy coral reef for an uneasy eating. It describes this reef which is thousands and thousands and thousands of miles away from people. Unexploited. These fish are so hungry that the divers there in Exala company complained about how these fish would all come and nibble their ears and try to see if there was any food there. These large predators represent the almost unexploited ecosystem, how they look originally. Now this is the reference point when we're talking about fishing down the food web. We're talking about a process that started a long time ago. And when you go out and you take a little piece of it, and you use an indicator for that, and you don't get the context you're working in. Yes, the indicator may tell you something else. It is really dangerous to rely on one indicator. Find me an investment banker that does that. I will probably be a former investment banker who has bankrupt all his customers. It just doesn't work. And that's a lesson that we need to keep in mind. And to me, separating the process from the indicator is an important step here. So why this controversy? Lots of this has to do with, I say, I say potato and you say potato. Different schools and different experiences is behind this. And what comes from there. This relates to Daniel having his formative years in the tropics. In the tropics, fisheries are not managed, really. So little management going on. You may hear that there's licenses that restrict entry, but can I buy a license? No, there are restrictions. Okay, that's how it works, many places. There's very little restrictions on entry to these fisheries. And that's scary. And what we've seen in developing countries is scary. It's over exploitation and it's not getting better. Now, that's the school there on the left. The other school on the right has a different experience. That's working in areas where you have well-managed where you now have well-managed fisheries. These are fisheries, if you look at what has happened in this area over the last 60 years, you see the doom, and you see it in the 70s, 80s, 90s, the build-up, but then they started working, the fisheries assessment people, and the management people, and the politicians, gradually, and they have turned the tide. Things have overall changed in the North Atlantic, the North Pacific, in Australia, in New Zealand, and these areas where it is well-managed fisheries. There has been an impact on assessments, thankfully, otherwise it would be a waste of effort. Now, add to this, when you have two personalities, like the Bolly and the Hillborn, clearly you can have everything you need to get into that, or WWF many years ago, I don't know what it's called now, fight. But not, you know, that kind of fight there. You have all the ingredients for such a fight when you get to this. Because, of course, Hillborn sees this as Daniel is in the pocket of the green environment and really saying that what we have been doing in the last 20 years on managing fisheries is not working and we need to replace it. And on the other hand, Daniel saying that Hillborn and his group are in the pocket of the industry and, you know, and so on. There is this aspect to it. Really, you're getting into this becoming. Another thing you have to learn is soccer and hockey are very different. Because in hockey, it's perfectly fine. You don't go after the puck, you go after the man. Right? In soccer is just the opposite. You're not allowed to do that. You have to go after the ball only. Here, you're getting into a little bit of going up the hockey mentality. You push the person more than the scientific issue. That's part of what I see. But I will still point out these controversies are healthy, that we have this happening, that we have this debate. I argue that because debates of this kind makes us question what we know about the ecosystems. And otherwise, we would be lulled into this, oh, everything is fine, we can go and, you know, and you can, you create, you construct, you build thing, and everything is fine, and so on. That's not interesting in science. It's good to have these controversies, absolute. And I end my talk here with quoting Ray Hilborn. He published an interesting paper, which is many ways are controversial, and it's controversial because many see it as Hilborn doing this on the conservation list. But, you know, he is talking about, it's a paper where he talks about faith-based science, how people get results of MPAs are great research, you know, no discussion, bang, like that's, you can get into that kind of faith-based that you just know it. You know the results of the science before you start out on it. That's where you get into to Ray Hilborn's faith-based science. Now that is dangerous. Can also relate to fisheries management. It doesn't have to be degrees. There are papers indicating faith-based science in all camps that are involved here. My point out, faith-based science, yes, it's something we should think about. It's also two-edged sword. It's not so that in this controversy here that one group is faith-based and the other is goes without religion. That's not what's happening in science here, in this. We're talking about different approaches, different ideas, starting off with, but it doesn't change. No matter where we are in these camps, we have to avoid this faith-based science. We have to go for, quoting Ray Hilborn, let's go back to testable hypothesis and evidence. Thank you. Oh, 11:41 took 6 minutes longer than I had.
No, you're fine.
Yeah, yeah.
So we've got 9 minutes for questions. Do you want to just monitor them yourself? Or? And we're starting with a student question.
Yeah, we're starting with students. There are no questions.
Are there questions?
There are no questions. No. Nobody there is. Oh. What do I have to do? Go look for a student. Come on. See, this is where you need an organizer to. You're number two now, Anna, for the first time.
No, so you're going for it. I was told I'm not allowed to ask the first question because I'm the organizer.
No, I didn't. Nobody says that, no. Please. So here. Please, first.
I wanted to know that when you talked about the indicators and with the healthy ecosystem and with the unfished or untouched ecosystem with the shark, I remember they talked about an integrated trophic pyramid as well, where you have the trophic benefits are actually a lot more than the lower trophic level. So is that, does that work? Is that really the case then in the untouched places?
Yes, it is when you look at biomasses. The biomass is much higher at higher trophic level, so you do get the inverted pyramid. But when you look at production, it cannot be the case. Do you know why? Cannot be the case? Because you can't change thermodynamics. So productivity has to be about 10 times higher, maybe a little bit less than that, when you go one trophic level down. So what you have in these systems is you have lots of plankton coming into them. Plankton, all of these fish we're looking here at here, they live on plankton and they hunt by the reef. So here they are competing a lot for food. Over here, the planktivores, there's a lot of food being brought to them. It's really dangerous. They're hiding in the reefs. The prey fish are there, but they're hiding. And they go out and they eat and they come back again. Typically dawn and dusk. They go out there. So there are a few of them. They have a quick turnover because they die. They are being eaten. But the turnover is quick. is quick enough to keep these very hungry top predators alive. And once you eat these eggs, you know, you can actually get by with less food. Same goes for us. We don't eat as relatively as much as children. So it works. It has a lot of controversies. For instance, when talking about how does old ecosystems look, you blow up the mountain cod on the East Coast. Well, what would they be eating? If you just do the calculations, oh, that's a problem. That's not enough capelin, that's not enough herring for them. Probably were, you know. So in all wise, no, not probably. There was enough food for them, because otherwise they would not have been there. So yeah, inverted pyramids, perfectly fine. Art. Ah, no, so here first.
Okay, so you said that you'd elaborate a little bit more about how fisheries also are possibly also driven by profits.
Yeah.
Now in a scenario where they are driven by profits, how would you imagine management adapting to that? Or how would you...
In the context of fishing down or in general?
In general, like down through but with profits also as an indicator.
I don't even know what school of economics we're into now here, because we do not do that. We do, you know, free rule of the economy. It's really difficult, and there's few industries that are more imaginative than the fishing industry. Maybe because I know it too, but you know, when there are opportunities, there are people who will find these opportunities and use them. See, that's one reason why I don't think the argument in the fishing down the food web is that strong. It may work in the short term, but when we turn to fishing for shrimp and so on, part of the reason for that is quite clear. It's because we're taking away the predators. There's a nice paper from 2003 by Van Myers and Boyce Worm that looks a meta study of cod and shrimp, and it clearly shows the different phases there. If you have no cod, you can get shrimp more than that, and vice versa. So it's not a question of, oh, fishes are changing to shrimp because it's more profitable. That's not the whole story. The story is also the shrimp are there because we have taken the predators out. Art.
So what would you do if you had a perfect indicator? I mean, does anyone really believe that we're not overfishing most of the populations out there?
In general or where?
In general.
Yes, I don't believe. And I did not say that 3 years ago. But when I look now at the assessments and what comes out of from the North Atlantic and also to some extent from the North Pacific, especially from the North Atlantic, you can see how in the 70s, 80s, 90s, we were talking about vast overexploitations. The median stock was being exploited at 2 or 3 times MSY. If you look at the most recent for all stocks that are quantified in the North Atlantic, which are all the important stocks, we are down where the median MSY is below, the median exploitation rate is below MSY level. So this is a very strong trend that has happened there. So yes, I believe that in the North Atlantic, things are changing. And I would not have thought I would ever say that until I say it now. 2 years ago, I would think this is Atlantis, this is pure imagination.
No, but what I'm saying is that we probably know that for when we look at any ecosystem, any terrestrial ecosystem, any aquatic ecosystem, any river, that we're probably overexploiting those systems. And we don't need an indicator to tell us that, or even if you had one, given how crappy the data is, that anyone could find anything that they wanted.
Sure. But how do we want the ecosystem to be? I think it's great that we have Kingman Reef and a few other places that look like this, but they can't feed us. I think we clearly need this kind of ecosystems as well if we want to eat fish.
But that's part of the disconnect between the long-term differences in biomass at trophic level the short-term differences in biomass at trophic levels. We have higher biomass at the higher trophic levels versus the production, which is higher at the lower trophic level. So if you're, in essence, if you're going out for one fishing season, you fish higher in the trophic level because you're more likely to get that kind of fish. Mm-hmm. But if you're looking 10 years, then you want to be fishing lower in the trophic level because it's more, is it going to be more sustainable?
I think you can, there's still this debate right now, sometimes a little bit silly debate about balanced fishing. It's led by FAO people, Jeppe Colling, Serge Garcia, people, Jeppe from Norway. But it's a whole movement. And it's a bit silly, because what they're saying is we have to fish everything. We have to fish everything in proportion to production. They're trying to create a rule. What I see that the only real achievement of their work, I think, because there's a lot of silly things in their assumptions, is the debate that they're creating. And the central part of that is, I think we can all agree to balance harvesting. We should not over-exploit the resources. But in this case, in their case, the balanced harvesting goes to some extremes. But yes, we should think about how we want to exploit these ecosystems. We should think we should not just think about how we how the fisheries survive this year. They have to survive this year. But we need to have a planning that talks about where are we going to be in the medium term, 5 to 10 years from now. The Department of Fisheries and Oceans has moved down that route by the Ecosystem Research Initiative. They've done that with a big initiative which is pure lip service. There's no funding behind it. They haven't even reached the level where they're starting to talk about the socioeconomic aspects of this. So Canada is lacking far behind it, because there are other areas where there's much more development on this front. And we need to get to that point where we look 5, 10 years ahead. It takes time to turn things around in the ecosystem. We do need to move in the right direction. The North Atlantic has, to a large extent, been doing that. It has been extremely difficult. There's no bigger joke around than the common fisheries policy of the EU, but it looks like they're actually managing to reduce fishing effort. At least when you base it on the information, the major studies that come out from there. Hilborn 2014, there was this paper this spring that gave a lot of these status for a lot of these stocks. Looks pretty convincing. Okay, we have to finish. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm.